Thank you very much. On moments like this, the biggest mistake you can do is to give a long speech. Honorable President, Honorable Outgoing President, Outgoing General Secretary, Honorable Delegates, Honorable Members of the General Committee who elected me, and those who are coming in, my sisters and brothers in Christ. First of all, I give thanks to God, the Almighty, for calling me to this service as General Secretary of AACC, something which some months ago I would not even think about as a possibility. It is a great honor. And I thank also my whole family, represented by my wife, for standing with me and supporting me in the decision to leave where I have been, where we have all been for some years, to come back home and serve the church and people of Africa. I thank my predecessor, Dr. Karamaga, and all the staff of AACC, past and present, for the many efforts they have put into work so that AACC is strong enough to attract and keep competent staff. I go there without fear. I want to publicly express my gratitude to Dr. Karamaga for his commitment to smoothly facilitate the transition which is before us. He's one of those leaders who hand over to their successors in joy and thanking God. It's not always the case. You know that. Why do I accept this position? I have been asked by my friends whether I have thought carefully enough before I decided to leave my secure job in Geneva and to come to Africa. Even my doctor said, "Are you crazy?" I want to say again, yes, I have thought carefully, we have prayed about it, we have talked about it, and I come to serve Africa from Africa for many reasons. One, I'm a child of Africa. This is where I was born, this is where I grew up, this is where I started, this is where I started my ministry, this is where I started my family, and I have always remained connected, no matter where I go. I'm committed to the cause and the welfare of Africa from the bottom of my heart, and have been sent to serve in the global ecumenical movement by my church, where I have gathered very useful experience, which I am glad to bring back into South Africa. I have clearly heard the call of the Lord that it's time to come back home. And because I have faith in Africa. And people ask, Africa? Yes. I'm aware of the bad image which Africa has, sadly, also among Africans and beyond Africa. It is identified with poverty. And I very much was following the sermon this morning. What names do people give us as Africans? They associate us with dirt, with disease, with conflict, with totalitarianism, with refugees, with begging, with migration, with all kinds of people. For some, it's a lost continent. I was telling the minister that one of my friends was here said, when he came here, he said, "This is for me, not Africa." And I said, when he saw the Congress, yeah, "This is for me, not Africa." I said, "Why?" Because so many people don't expect something like this to be in Africa. For others, it is a continent which needs pity of the rest of the world. It is a continent which, when it shows its best, some say it's not. I come to Africa because my perception of Africa is very different. Africa is to me a continent of hope. I'm tired of those who ignore the development in Africa, choosing instead to focus on only bad news, which feed their stereotyped perception of Africa, while ignoring anything good coming out of Africa. I want to contribute to changing the narrative about Africa by focusing primarily on great achievements and opportunities available every day in Africa, while of course not ignoring the challenges and problems we are facing. Without ignoring the conflicts in countries like DRC, Central African Republic, South Sudan and Chad, how about focusing on tremendous successes of democracy and rule of law, which has overcome conflicts in Ethiopia recently, Zimbabwe, South Africa, Kenya to a certain extent. I mean, it was not a real conflict. You don't hear about this. You don't hear that the Ethiopian government, the Ethiopian people have resolved their conflict without war, without intervention of anybody. So was South Africa, changing the regime, administration change, all Zimbabwe. Why don't we hear this? How about the fact that Africa has countries with the fastest growing economies in the world at the moment? Social development is also extraordinary, with majority of the people having access to education, health, communication, financial services, etc. I was told that this country is almost reaching the targets of Millennium Development Goals, I think by 80%. They don't talk about this. Africa is a vibrant church, and faith still matters to the people, even though faith is sometimes a major cause of conflict as well, like it is in the whole world. And Africa is a continent of celebration and joy for most of its people, even when they do not have the excesses in life like the other continents. Challenges like loneliness and depression are not known here. If you want to be poor, you study to be a psychologist in Africa. Because Africans don't go to psychologists, they are not going to pay money to go to get some counseling. Because the society, the system, it works. You don't get all these depressed people killing themselves, even if they're poor. My Africa, therefore, is a continent of hope, a continent on the rise. And this is my perception. That's why I'm coming to serve the church here. And a little bit about the church. I come to AACC because I have passion for the ministry of the church in Africa. AACC, I believe, is an instrument of the churches in Africa. It is a strong ecumenical organization with a continental presence and reach. It has good leadership and established legacy. And for this, I'm indebted to our predecessors. It is an organization which grows and transforms itself as it adapts to new needs of the churches in Africa. I look forward to continuing the successful programs of ACC, like Campaign for African Dignity, Advocacy at the African Union, Agenda 2063, Ecumenical Theological Education in Africa, Gender Justice, and many, many, many others. But also we will pursue new emerging themes which this General Assembly has identified, particularly the challenge of migration and population explosion, as well as special focus on the youth. I look forward to consolidate the financial situation of AACC towards its eventual sustainability. So where will be my emphasis? This is always a question. I have been asked many times. The answer is clear. I'm not the organization. The emphasis will be determined by the members through your general committee, through this assembly. That is why we, as your servants, will implement what you say. But there are three things which I must say now organizationally. One, we must make sure we maintain our thematic relevance. We must do what the members want and other stakeholder organizations in Africa want us and expect us to do. Because if they don't address what they need, it is just irrelevant and nobody cares whether you exist or not. The second is organizational or institutional sustainability, which depends on engaged membership, committed staff, and trustworthy partners. And I would like to pursue growth and deepening of AACC as an indispensable ecumenical organ of the member churches, which takes seriously the changing ecclesial and political context. I must mention, as an example, we need to reach out to more churches to join, particularly the new and bigger ones, growing ones, with whom we have sometimes less theological affinity. I would very much like to focus on theological development, meaning that AACC being an incubator for theologians with competence and expertise who can explore, propagate, and present the African theological perspectives, even at global levels, with exceptional competence. Therefore, I see this as God's call. And we are only responding and humbly accepting. And one of the most difficult things to discern is, how do you know God is calling you? I wish God was sending SMS messages or writing emails. We would all follow it, but unfortunately he doesn't. He hides somewhere, we pray, sometimes we don't even know whether what we are doing is God's will or not. So for many years I decided, for me, the knowledge of God's will come through my church. And in this case, it's through you. You have elected me, you have called me, I take this as God's call. And I always see my task as a leader, not as a driver of a bus, whose passengers are simply waiting until the bus reaches its destination. But I see myself as a football captain. No matter how skilled and gifted the captain is, like Messi and I don't know who, Neymar, who are getting millions for one. All those people, they are totally dependent on how their fellow team members play. If they don't play well, their expertise is nothing. We have leaders of member churches, we have governance bodies, we have staff at all levels, we have partners in many countries. Each of us make this team. Without cooperation and playing together, no matter what we do, nothing will succeed. Therefore, I count on all of you. But most importantly, I say, like, Lord, if you don't go with me, I don't go. I need God's guidance and accompaniment throughout the way. And thank you, Bishop Shaw, for your message, which I understood very clearly. And I think, I'm sure he did, because we know each other for a long time. I'm not one of those people who introduce myself as doctor or general secretary of what. If people cannot know you are general secretary, then you have a problem, if you have to say it. I'm comforted by the Lord when he promised Joshua in the text we read, as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. This is my trust in God. I wanted to sing a song, but apparently we could not logistically make it. But I will just sing the chorus, which I have been singing several times this year. Maybe some of you know it. I, the Lord of skies. And the chorus says, here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. Thank you very much. God bless you.